36, Gather Us In. God and one another, our joys, our cares, our concerns. So are there any prayer requests this morning? I've been given a blanket prayer request for everyone going through procedures and recovery because there seems to be a lot, but if there's any more to add to that, Linda.
Chris again. Chris Isler.
And that is addiction, correct?
On the list, and of course, Louise Carter and the family.
I would ask for a prayer for Ryan. Ryan is the son of one of my old college roommates. She doesn't post much on Facebook, but she put out a prayer request this week because he's got to be in his early 30s, and he's in the ICU. Intubated with COVID. So. Okay. Let us pray. Almighty, eternal, gracious God, once again we have gathered together. We have gathered because you have called us, you have pulled us, you have tugged at our hearts, you have filled our souls, and we know how blessed we are. So we are here, Lord, to give you thanks to worship you, to praise you, and to just offer ourselves to you once again. Because you are the God of love. You are the God who watches over us, the God who gives us whatever we may need in life, be it direction, wisdom, guidance, strength, mercy, forgiveness, grace, all those things, Lord, you pour out abundantly on us, and we are grateful. So, Lord, as we gather, we give you our hearts this day, and just thank you and praise you for all that you do for us. May we live our lives in praise and thanks to you. As we gather with cares and concerns in our hearts that we place on your altar at this time. Lord, there are many this week, past week, who just seem to be going through a lot. So, Lord, for all of those who are going through procedures this coming week or recovering from procedures that have already happened, for those who are waiting for test results, for all those kind of situations, Lord, we ask your blessing and your mercy on them. We ask that you will heal all those who need healing and give strength and renewal to those who are recovering, and just for all people involved, Lord, and you know who they are. We just pray for their healing and for their recovery to fullness and wholeness of health. And Lord, we continue our prayers for Chris, who is struggling with the demon of addiction. This is one of the toughest ones to be rid of, Lord, and get rid of. So we ask in your name that you will get this demon out of him and help him, Chris, to become back to a normal and healthy and joyful life. Keep him strong and help him to fight this so that he may get through this and just recover fully. And for Carter and his family, Lord, it's a continual prayer to thank you for watching over him and keeping him in your care and keeping him so strong, but continue to carry him, watch over him, guide the doctors caring for him, and just give patience and strength to the family also, Lord, caring for him. Just be with them all, and may they feel your presence and be at peace. And for Ryan, Lord, and all those who are in the ICUs, who are struggling with COVID or anything else, we pray that for their recovery, we pray for his fullness of health to return, and we just pray that he will get through this and live a long, healthy, and happy life. And Lord, there are those who are worshiping with us from their kitchens and from their couches, and they also have prayer concerns that they place on your altar at this time. Lord, for all those who have been named that need your healing touch, we ask you as our great physician to return them to fullness and wholeness of health. For those who have been named that are grieving, we ask that your spirit brings them comfort and peace. And for all those who've just shared a joyful moment in life, we just give you thanks for being there, making it all the more joyful. And as always, Lord, we pray for this world. Where there's war, let there be peace. Where there's oppression, let there be freedom. Where there's hunger, may they be fed. Where there's illness, may they be healed. Through us, through others, may this world come to know the peace and the kingdom you have promised. Through Christ our Lord, who taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For yours is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen.
Thank you.
song before in a church setting? Appropriate.
Yes. Yeah. You think Who was the group that made it famous, Jim?
Oh, Simon and Garfunkel.
Garfunkel.
Yeah, of course.
I can hear God saying those words.
Yes.
Wow. Chills. Anyway, our first reading today should be fairly well known. It's 1 Corinthians 13. If I speak in tongues of men or angels but do not have love, I am only a resounding gong or a clanging cymbal. I give all my possessions to the poor and give over my body to hardship that I may boast, but do not have love, I gain nothing. Love is patient, love is kind. It does not envy, it does not boast, it is not proud, it does not dishonor others, it is not self-seeking, it is not easily angered, it keeps no record of wrongs. Love does not delight in evil, but rejoices with truth. It always protects, always trusts, always hopes, always perseveres. Love never ends. But where there are prophecies, they will cease. Where there are tongues, they will be stilled. Where there is knowledge, it will pass away. For we know in part, and we prophesy in part. But when completeness comes, what is in part disappears. When I was a child, I talked like a child. I thought like a child. I reasoned like a child. When I became a man, I put away the ways of childhood behind me. For now we see only a reflection as in a mirror. Then we shall see face to face. Now I know in part, then shall I know fully, even as I am fully known. And now these three things remain, faith, hope, and love. But the greatest of these is love. If we could stand and sing The Gift of Love, number 408. From last week's gospel reading, Jesus began by saying to them, "Today, this scripture is fulfilled in your hearing." All spoke well of him and were amazed at the gracious words that came from his lips. "Isn't this Joseph's son?" they asked. And Jesus said to them, "Surely you will quote this proverb to me, 'Physician, heal yourself.' And you will tell me, 'Do here in your hometown what we have heard that you did in Capernaum.' Truly, I tell you," he continued, "no prophet is accepted in his hometown. I assure you that there were many widows in Israel in Elijah's time when the sky was shut for 3.5 years and there was severe famine throughout the land. Yet Elijah was not sent to any of them, but to a widow in Zarephath in the region of Sidon. And there were many in Israel with leprosy at the time of Elisha the prophet, yet not one of them was cleansed, only Naaman the Syrian. All the people in the synagogue were furious when they heard this. They got up, drove him out of town, and took him to the brow of the hill on which the town was built in order to throw him off the cliff. But Jesus walked right through the crowd and went on his way. This is the word of God for the people of God.
Thanks be to God.
Please be seated. Get this so it works to its fullest capacity. If I can speak in tongues of men and angels, but have not love, I am a clanging cymbal, etc., etc. I had kind of an epiphany as I read through the Corinthians reading of the full analogy that Paul was trying to give in those opening lines of the Corinthians passage, which I'm assuming all of you have heard at least once at a wedding. If there's any reading, I think this tops the list of wedding readings, because it is. After that part, it goes on to be a beautiful passage about love is patient, love is kind, love is all these wonderful things that couples think of on the day of their marriage. But interestingly enough, not many of them have that opening paragraph about, without love, you're a clanging cymbal and a noisy sound. Which is one of the reasons I want us to focus on this passage today, because it is so familiar in a specific setting. You won't hear this passage at a funeral. You won't hear this passage at a christening or anything. It's always at weddings. And so it's an easy place to go to when we hear it. The problem is, Paul didn't write this passage because one of his relatives was getting married and they asked him for a good set of words. Paul wrote this passage, the whole letter to Corinth, because the church in Corinth was not behaving itself, shall we say, politely. And we know this because the paragraphs, the chapters leading up to this, specifically this is in the middle between chapters 12 and 14, Paul discussed a lot of things that it sounded that the church was doing and doing badly. They were doing things like not honoring the Lord's Supper. If you know your scripture well, there are points in scripture where Jesus said every time you do this, when you sit down and break bread or drink a cup, do it, remember him. So it was supposed to be at every meal that you remembered the Lord. So when the faithful got together, when the church got together, they would have a full meal. The problem was the rich people who didn't have to work but sent their servants to do work always got there first and ate all the food. So when the servants could finally get there, there was nothing left. So the church was doing these kind of things. They were, not, like I said, honoring the Lord's Supper properly. They were boasting and bragging and trying to decide which spiritual gifts were better than others. And so that's why in chapter 12, which if I had you read it, was a lectionary last week, you would have heard about the body of Christ, how we are all a part of the body. And not everyone can be an ear. If everyone was an ear, how could we see? If everyone was an eye, how could we taste? It talked about every part of the body being important and no part greater than another. So all this is leading up to this chapter 13, where he talks about love and how love is what it's supposed to be and what it is not. And I like it how he interwove the list, so it could be crystal clear about what love is and what love is not. If you hear the things love is not, it is not envious. It is not boastful or arrogant or rude. It doesn't insist on its own way. It's not irritable or resentful. It doesn't rejoice in wrongdoing. But the things love is patient and kind and rejoices in truth, bears all things, believes all things, hopes and endures all things. Understand that for someone to write a letter in biblical times, I'm not sure if I've ever shared this with you. I know in my past where I've done this, said this a few times in my sermons, scholars have somehow estimated, guesstimated, whatever, that in biblical times, 1 in 1,000 people could write, and 1 in 100 people could read. And then you have to get either the papyrus or the parchment. I always get these confused. One is made out of plants, and one is made out of animal skins that has been specially cured and scraped and all that good stuff and then sewn together. So to write something down, it was very important. And they didn't use words frivolously. There would have been no Harlequin romance novels back in the day. It took too much to write things down. So for Paul to write these things down, to list what love is not, and to write what love is, should be, it's safe to assume that the church in Corinth was doing what love is not, and not doing what love is. So instead of being a wonderfully warm and fuzzy passage that can be read at weddings about love, this letter was a slap in the face to the people of the church in Corinth. It was to remind them of how they're supposed to be acting, not how they're acting, and to remind them how they're acting was very much against the gospel of Jesus Christ. And so that's kind of the letter to us today. If we think about how divisive the church is, how divisive that church was, that people thinking their spiritual gift was better than so-and-so's, or they were better than so-and-so, et cetera, et cetera. You know, they were being so arrogant and so uppity. Have you ever tried to Google the phrase Christians are? A friend of mine, a colleague, had me do this probably over 5 years ago. It wasn't here yet. I was at Johnsonburg Church. And you would be surprised at what comes up on the internet. At that point in time, things like I Googled Christians are, hit enter, and things like judgmental, nasty, uncaring, self-righteous. And if you think about our mainline denominations, membership is down across the board in every place. And why? And a lot of times the answer is, well, people who go to church don't act like they go to church. You know, outside that 1 hour on Sunday mornings, you'd never know that they call themselves Christians. They have become clanging bells and noisy cymbals, because they're doing things not with love. They're becoming like that church in Corinth, or they are that church in Corinth, who are bragging, who are resentful, who are boastful, all the things we should not be. If there's any passage, in my opinion, in Scripture, that tells the church to be all-inclusive for all people, for our denomination, this is the one. That we should not be restricting anybody in membership, restricting anybody in what they could be doing in the church. This passage, above all else, tells us we are to be open and loving and kind to everyone. This is a huge letter to today's church, to today's community, to today's people. And this is where it starts. It starts with the people in the churches. Each one of us represent the church, the greater church and Walnut Valley Church. And so how we act outside these four walls will tell the people in this community what kind of church we are. And I love how Paul writes in verse 8, how love never ends. And as I was kind of like, what was he thinking about when he wrote that? Or what does he mean by that? what came to my mind is the fact that I have done lots of funerals. You can ask Glenn and Larry. He's the one who hired me. I stopped counting after 100. I don't know if I've done over 200 in my pastorate here in this community. And I can tell you, I cannot recall a single funeral where a family member or a friend stood up and boasted about the deceased's big house or fancy car or their position in life. They always stood up and talked about how that person added to their life, how that person made them feel loved, how that person just made them smile. Now, I can tell you beforehand, because 9 times out of 10, I don't know the deceased when I'm doing a funeral. So I'll get contact info and I'll call a family member and just talk with them and say, yeah. And you know, a lot of that, tell me about your loved one. And lots of times I will get, oh, they were a stubborn SOB. Or they were a cranky pain in the arse. Or they were, yeah. But those kind of phrases were quickly followed by, but pastor, please don't bring that up at the funeral. It seems that when it's our last goodbye, we want to remember our loved one's better angel. And the love that they gave us, the laughter that they shared, the way they made us feel. And to me, and this is one way where love never ends. We kind of instinctively know that that's the important thing to remember and bring up and celebrate at the time. So this letter is a letter to each one of us. It's a letter to our church. It's a letter to the church at large about living in love. And may it make you think about when it's your time. Do you want to be remembered as a clanging cymbal and a noisy gong? Or do you want people to celebrate your legacy of love that you have blessed their lives with? The choice is yours. Amen.
You can bring up the negative things of mine.
I can?
Yes. I'll write it.
Please join me in responding in faith. Gracious God, purveyor of all that is good, give us a vision of our world as your love would make it, a world where the weak are protected and none go hungry or poor, a world where the benefits of civilized life is shared and everyone can enjoy them, a world where different races, nations, and cultures live in tolerance and mutual respect, a world where peace is built with justice and justice is guided by love. And give us the inspiration and the courage to build it through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Now is our time to offer our gifts and ourselves. Please join me in dedicating our offering. God of the heavens, we give these offerings in gratitude, rejoicing in the abundance of your gifts to us. We give these offerings in faith, trusting that you will provide for our needs. We give these offerings in hope, knowing you can use them to spread your love in this world. And with these offerings, we give ourselves. Amen. Let us stand and sing the closing hymn, number 2190, Bring Forth the Kingdom. Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen.